Welcome to Thinking Green, the public access show that's produced by the New London Green Party. I'm Rana, and about 6 months ago, Colin Bennett was on the show. He was running for state senate in the 33rd district, which is the Connecticut River Valley. And we talked about a lot of issues, but not really, we didn't get to everything we wanted to. So Colin is back tonight. And he is the founder of a group called Allies for Social Justice. And as it turns out, social justice was one of the topics that kind of got short shrift when he was on the show last time. So we'll devote most of tonight's show to that. So welcome, Colin.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
Thanks for coming on. I guess I wanted to start out asking you, how you got involved in work. Anti-oppression work.
Sure. It's actually kind of a long story, so I'll try to give you the abbreviated version. Essentially, I would say that I've been an environmentalist for a really long time, and that was kind of my introduction to activism, is environmental activism. And I was actually at a environmentalist training camp in Ohio a long time ago, and as part of this training camp, which was being hosted by the Student Environmental Action Coalition, they had a lot of workshops that were on, anti-oppression, whether it be dismantling racism or other similar workshops. And they were, I'm reluctant to say the word mandatory, but they were the type of workshops where it's the only thing that's on the schedule, so everybody was expected to attend. And those workshops really opened my eyes to problems that I'd never seen before, namely, at that point, racism. And it was presented to me in a way that I'd never thought about in my life, because it had never been taught to me, nor had it been, presented to me in any way. So as a result of that, I started seeking out more workshops and training similar to that, specifically on anti-racism. And throughout the years, I just became more and more committed to it, and started traveling around, making new connections, making new friends and colleagues, allies, and then eventually just started doing the work on my own or with partners or with other folks that were interested in this. So that's kind of the abbreviated version again.
Now, you fairly recently founded a group called Allies for Social Justice. Can you tell us a little bit about the group?
Sure. Allies for Social Justice is kind of just a continuation of that story. As I was traveling around, I was meeting people that were doing the same or similar work, and we came together kind of in an ad hoc way. It's, people that were committed to this doing work on their own, be like, all right, let's work together in some shape or form, whether it being offering or facilitating workshops or usually like something like that, offering or facilitating workshops in different parts of the country. And then sometimes we would offer workshops, and then there'd be people who'd be like, hey, I really want to get involved. And it would just kind of be a loose network of people from around the country that were committed to anti-oppression work. So we originally kind of came together on Facebook under the name Anti-Oppression Resources. It was a way for us to share all the different things that we had, all the online resources with the people that we were meeting. And then we kind of just transitioned into Allies for Social Justice. And now there's a lot of different people involved in a lot of different capacities. So it's just a matter of, who's available when and to do what. And it's still very much an ad hoc organization, but we do trainings pretty much around the country, anti-oppression trainings, for mostly, small nonprofit groups and things like that, sometimes student groups. It's all volunteer, and it's all unpaid work. So, if we travel somewhere, we're not getting paid for it or anything like that. Perhaps we'll get a stipend for travel, but that's about it.
Now, you've been holding conversations in Connecticut as well on a regular basis, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So After traveling around and doing this work in a lot of other places, I saw the need to do this in and around my community, is bring this conversation to where I live, which is, like you said, the Lower Connecticut River Valley. So the idea is to just create a forum where folks can talk about the need for racial justice in Connecticut and then beyond. So we started back in December with monthly meetings. Once a month meetings in different, or it's always been at the library, the Essex Library, up until this point. But again, it's just to try to foster communication among folks that are interested and willing to do something to promote racial justice.
Now, you came at it from an environmental point of view. Is environmental justice still one of the focuses of the group, or has it branched out to other areas?
Well, what Allies for Social Justice isn't focused on environmental justice. I think what we look at it, and everybody could answer this question differently, so I'll just answer it from my point of view. The way I look at it is that, you know, we can't have A better way to say that is, there's a lot of people out there that are very committed to protecting the environment, which is very, I don't know, noble, or it's a very worthy cause. But there's so many of those folks fail to realize that the intersectionality between issues like racism or homophobia or sexism or patriarchy are going hand in hand. It's generally a very similar mindset that allows the destruction of the environment, that allows the oppression of people. So without addressing one, we're not going to be able to solve either. I mean, addressing both, we're not going to be able to solve either.
So you kind of take a very broad view of it.
Right.
Now, it's called Allies for Social Justice, but talking to you before the show, you had a particular interest in racial justice at this point. And we've been seeing across the country, of course, instances of racial injustice played out in many ways in many places. Maybe we can talk a little bit about all the different places and manifestations of racism that we see.
Sure. So, like I mentioned, during that first kind of experience with seeing racism as a problem that's, because prior to that, I think for myself, I looked at racism as an individual or, one-on-one problem. It's people using the N-word or doing something along those lines, which I think most people think of it, be like, oh, I don't say the N-word, or I have black friends, or...
Yeah, so I'm not a bigot, so there isn't racism.
Right, exactly. And that workshop had showed me that, racism exists on an institutional level, that all the institutions that we have in this country that our country operates under are all, in fact, racist institutions. And that was the mind-blowing thing. It's I can be a person that's not acting in a racist way, but I'm still benefiting from this racist system, which is, we say racism, but the term that I think that we really should be using is white supremacy, because that's what we're defining, which is this racist system, which has white people at the top at the expense of people of color.
And it's really hard for people to talk about, supremacy or even privilege. I think we all want to feel like we deserve to be exactly where we are, and not that we were helped along by the institutions.
Right. There's this myth of, pull yourself up by the bootstraps, which doesn't exist. I mean, this country was founded on the genocide of one culture or many cultures of people, essentially a whole continent of peoples, and then built upon the impacts of another continent when we imported people from Africa to do all of the work in this country, or the vast majority of a lot of the work. So it's white folks specifically think there's that analogy or that metaphor, I get them confused, where it's like, oh, I succeeded, I hit a home run, but what they really did, they were bored on third base and they made it that last 90 feet, and that's what they consider success. And then as far as this goes, I think that, when we talk about privilege, I have privilege as a white person to talk to other white people in a way that a person of color wouldn't necessarily be able to do. So I think it's my responsibility to do work like this, this anti-racism work. And that's why, even though I live in a predominantly white community, I think that these community conversations on racial justice, for example, are so imperative to have, because, this is where my agency is talking to other white folks about how, structural racism and the things that, you don't see on a day-to-day basis unless you're paying attention.
And, I feel that a lot as well. Not, there are a few of us who have had a ritual for many years that we hold peace signs up at the monument in New London. And one of the reasons we do it, we're all, you know, middle-aged white people, is we know we won't be harassed by the police.
Right.
There are some people who, if they were engaged in that same behavior, would be harassed.
Absolutely.
But we have only been asked to leave once when there was construction. We actually stood out there for about a year when there was construction going on, and only once did the police officer ask us to move to the sidewalk. We've never really had a bad experience, but there are a lot of people who live in New London, because we're a pretty diverse community, who probably wouldn't feel safe doing what we're doing.
Sure. And I think that comes up a lot in my experience with, you know, environmental activism. People would be planning protests or rallies or anything of the sort without necessarily looking at the different dynamics that, you know, levels or structural or institutional oppression can play, and how the different people that might participate in that or might potentially participate in that will be affected by those systems of oppression, which, you know, so many groups have no lens or analysis of that for the longest time. And I think more and more environmental organizations or groups are starting to think along those terms, but it's like, you know, here we are at zero, and like maybe we've gone this far when we really need to be way over here. So yeah, there's still a lot of work to do, but I think that, again, we need to look at all the things that we do, no matter what the issue that you're working on. If it's not specifically anti-racism work or anti-oppression work, whatever other issue it is, you need to be looking at that with an anti-oppressive lens or focus.
Well, looking at some of the things that you've discussed in some of these past conversations, it might start before schools, but we're really seeing the systemic racism in our public school system.
Right.
The school to prison pipeline is starting to get a little bit of recognition. What do you see, I guess, how that manifests and what we can do about it?
So the way I talk a lot, you'll hear me use like terms of race a lot, because again, that's my background and that's what I guess I'm most familiar talking about. So I'll just kind of focus on anti-racism. But when we talk about racism as a system of oppression, it's not just those, there's the word that I'm struggling for, but the interactions between, interpersonal interactions,
yeah.
Which a lot of people, again, think it is. So that is, racism can manifest itself interpersonally. It could be, you know, something as seemingly benign as like telling a racist joke, benign compared to some other, you know,
right.
a black man being targeted by a white police officer and being shot to death. You know, there's like this spectrum of like where racism can manifest itself on an interpersonal level, because that white police officer shooting to death the young black man, that's still interpersonal. However, it's not just interpersonal, because interpersonal feeds from organizational. When organizational, like the police officer is part of a police department where behavior like that is either tolerated or not tolerated, but then also is part of what many people would call the criminal justice system, but I actually refer to it as the mass incarceration system, because I don't think we have anything close to criminal justice in this country. We really have mass incarceration of essentially black and brown people, and especially young black and brown men, but not necessarily, because we're seeing increasing numbers of young women of color going to prison for crimes that a white woman would not necessarily go to jail for at all, if even having been, you know, arrested in the first place, let alone, you know, standing trial. So the point is, we have interpersonal, we have organizational, and then we have the institution. So again, the individual police officer, or let's take it away from that, because I don't want to feel like I'm targeting police. Let's say it's a teacher in a school who treats a young child of color differently because it's that person is a person of color. The child. So that's tolerated within the school system or not, you know, the individual school system, based on, you know, any number of factors, the school board, the administration, the superintendent, so forth. But then that's part of our larger, again, people call it the education system, but I'll call it the compulsory schooling system, because I think that we don't have a really great education system and it's not really fair to call it that. But then, so we have interpersonal, mm-hmm. We have organizational, we have institutional, which then the overarching umbrella is the cultural racism, which kind of allows all of this to happen, you know, and is largely invisible. You know, we can see manifestations of that all the time. And like a common one that if you pay attention to is standards of beauty, like who we see on TV or who we see in magazines and who are our models and things like that, which again is this culture, what type of holidays we celebrate, you know, or you know, we get days off for is kind of this this idea of cultural oppression or racism. So it's all of these different things interplaying with each other. You don't really have one without the other because the individuals make up the organizations make up the institutions, and then collectively the institutions make up the culture. So it's again this kind of this interlocking system.
It seems as though the farther away you go from the individual, though, the more invisible and unconscious the racism is, that, you know, if someone, you know, uses the N-word, or there was an incident just at Khan College the other day, the racist graffiti was found in a restroom, and everyone, actually the school shut down for a day for anti-racism workshops, so they responded immediately. But when you're talking about standards of beauty, that's something that people have a sense of, but they don't really think about it unless you point it out.
I think that, it depends on like what aspects of the standard of beauty we're talking about, you know, because there's obviously, you know, skin tone or like skin color, but then there's also body weight issues and like what type of body styles are popularized in our magazines and our TV shows. So that's like, that is, when we have to look at things intersectionally, because all of these systems of oppression, whether it be, you know, the patriarchy or the white supremacy, or the, you know, or heteronormativity, all of these things are really going hand in hand. So yeah, it's important to look at, you know, to look at these things and not just have the single issue focus, because, you know, then if we do that, we're destined to fail.
Well, then we get all of our work kind of bumping against each other.
Right.
And, you know,
it can definitely. And it can be very, I don't want to say difficult work, but it requires a lot of intention, I think, to do anti-oppression work, because you have to be able to recognize, again, the intersectionality of the different issues while not ignoring any particular issue. You know, a lot of folks, I won't say a lot, but in my experience, people will say, you know, well, this type of oppression is worse than this. Racism was worse than patriarchy or something like that, which is super problematic because oppression is oppression. And there's a saying that, you know, I use and some other folks on the news use, you know, when people are talking about, you know, what's worse, that's often referred to as the oppression Olympics. And, you know, when you play the oppression Olympics, everybody loses. So again, we have to be able to see things as interlocking systems of oppression and how the intersectionality affects whatever situation we're talking about.
Now, you mentioned before about, you know, incarceration, and I know when you were on before, we talked about the war on drugs too. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, some people, you hear all the time, well, if people don't want to do the time, they shouldn't do the crime. And yet the reality of our criminal justice system is not really expressed accurately through that.
Right.
So what's the status of our criminal justice system and our incarceration?
Quite frankly, I believe that our criminal justice system is fundamentally racist. I think it's targeting, you know, people of color, specifically young people of color, with, you know, we have incarceration, which we could have, you know, we could have a whole kind of conversation just about a mass incarceration and like what the point of it and who's it serving, because I believe it's really not serving anyone except for increasingly the corporations that are operating the prisons. So I think that if you have the most anti-oppressive police force, for example, that is very clearly not racial profiling or doing anything that could even be considered or engaging in anything that could be considered racist behavior, that police force is still operating within this larger system where the laws that they're enforcing are created almost without exception by white men, you know, who are writing those laws almost entirely to benefit themselves. We can't just say we can't focus on the one part of it. We have to look at the big picture.
And as you were talking about the laws, I was thinking in many public places in downtown New London, there are signs saying, no panhandling. And that isn't necessarily a racist issue, but it demonstrates how laws affect different people differently. Most of us who are financially stable will never be panhandling, but those members of our society who are barely hanging on, they're the ones who are going to be breaking the law because it's really directed towards them.
Right.
I wanted to talk a little bit when you mentioned how incarceration affects young people of color so much more than other groups. The disenfranchisement that kind of follows people with a criminal record all their life. It isn't just, you were caught with some drugs, you spend 2 years in jail, in prison. Your whole life can be affected.
Right. I mean, that's true. I think that's true. It's true for anybody that's been affected by this system, the criminal justice system and the mass incarceration. So not necessarily just the people of color, anybody who's unfortunately been convicted of, even some of the least misdemeanors can have that negatively affect them for their lives. But of course, as we already, pointed out that, it's people of color that are being targeted by this system much more than white people.
Yeah, I think that for drug offenses, no matter what demographic you look at, drug use is fairly stable across all groups, and yet arrests and incarceration for drug use is totally not even across all different demographic groups or
Absolutely.
Different racial groups. So, there have been... In the last conversation you had, which was March 17th, and I'm guessing you'll have one in April, people can go to your Facebook page and find out the details?
Yeah, we use Facebook as a primary form of outreach just because, again, we're pretty much an ad hoc group we're all volunteer-based. We don't have a budget or anything like that. So we use Facebook. It's just facebook.com/AlliesForSocialJustice. And we post all of the, all of the things that we do on there. I work, as you know, as a substitute teacher. And in the school district that we have as requirements for graduation, folks, graduating seniors have to do community service in this count. So we actually have some interns working with us or starting to work with us, which I think is really great because I think that, young people, I think things are different now than things are changing. And I think in some ways, in very, very small ways, things are changing for the better. And I have a lot of hope when I look at young people, although, there's lots and lots of young people out there that are like inherently racist. There's a lot more that aren't, I think. And I think that sometimes we see progress in like mass media and things like that. We see, positive role models of color in places that we wouldn't have seen them even when I was a kid, which wasn't that long ago. So I think that the young people, essentially give me hope that things might get better.
That's good to hear. And I noticed that, of course, when my kids were growing up, some issues, I noticed that 20 years ago started getting better. Some ingrained prejudices just seemed like they were dissolving in the younger generation. But I must say it's very embarrassing to me. A lot of people in positions of power are baby boomers like me. And, despite the reputation of the 60s, it's not really been an enlightened leadership for the most part.
Well, that's debatable, I think, because I feel like the leadership has known exactly what they're doing, which is trying to keep people like them in power, and they've done a really good job of it, Out of Congress, 535 people, right? Like how many of those 535 people are white men? the vast majority of them, you know. So again, we see a little bit of progress, but we have like worlds, like we have so much work to do.
Yes, and unfortunately, it seems as though many of the white men are just, I don't know, they make you shake your head, some of the things they say. It isn't as though they seem really enlightened or intelligent or, you know, full of wisdom.
Right. I mean, especially when we see, you know, candidates for election, whether it be, you know, on the presidential level or the congressional level, just saying the most asinine things, you know. Usually, I think that, you know, the war on women that I think is perpetuated largely by the Republican Party, it's just, wow.
Even in Connecticut, there was a quote going around today that a state rep, I believe, in Connecticut said something like, rape usually goes unwitnessed unless it's a really great party.
Really? Yeah, I didn't
hear
about
that. Yeah, and that was Connecticut.
Horrible,
so
right?
It's kind of shocking that someone who's representing citizens in Connecticut is thinking that way. Any other kind of assault, I'm sure, wouldn't make for that kind of a joke.
Right, no, that is shocking. But then again, not, you know. Anyway.
Now, I want to let people know that if you want to call in with comments or questions, you're welcome to. We'll put the number up. So I guess before we talk about some other aspects of social justice, I thought I'd ask you, as, you know, a white male, what can allies do?
Sure. Yeah, I'm glad you asked that. But there's some answers to that question. But before we get to that, I think we should talk about the term ally, because a lot of people will use that term as kind of like a self-imposed or badge of honor, be like, oh, I'm an ally, and people don't realize that being an ally is not an identity. I don't think of myself as a white ally. I don't operate in the world as a white ally. I think that I could act as a white ally, but being an ally is not an identity, it's a process. And so it's something that takes constant effort. It's not something that if you're gonna do the work of an ally, it's not something you can do when you feel like it, you know? It's not something that you're just doing when it's easy. It's something that's a lifelong commitment. And this is for, you know, being a straight ally or a male ally or a cis ally, anything along those lines. Again, it's not an identity. So I don't generally use the term, and even though with an organization called Allies for Social Justice, the way I look at our name, Allies for Social Justice, is in the true sense of allyship, where it's not, you know, a person from a privileged identity is helping somebody from an oppressed or marginalized identity. It's where everybody can be allies, and we can all help each other and work toward, you know, collective liberation or toward a better future. So allies are people coming together, at least in the context of Allies for Social Justice, people coming together. But again, like in terms of being an ally or doing the work of an ally, I think the most important thing to realize is that it's not something that it's only to do when it's comfortable. In fact, to be an ally, like by definition, you're going to have to do work that takes you out of your comfort zone in order to succeed, because, you know, it's impossible not to, to step out of your comfort zone. Even if it's something as simple as like interrupting a racist joke, you know, overhearing a racist joke and going up and telling those people like, that's not cool, you can't do that here, or I don't want to hear that. You know, that's a very, very simple thing. But again, for the vast majority of people, I think it takes them out of their comfort zone to confront people and the whatever oppressive behavior those people are engaging in.
Now, I wondered if you have ever found yourself in a situation where you've done that and you've gotten some pushback. It's like, I thought you were one of us, but I guess you're not.
Probably. I think most people, they also don't want to be confrontational. So, and a lot of people, nobody wants to be called racist or oppressive for the most part, or very few people, I guess I should say. However, there's a great video on the internet. I forget who does it, but he's a gentleman spends the time saying that if you're going to, you know, interrupt racist behavior, it's very, very important to address the behavior and not the person. It's not to say you're racist because you say that behavior is racist because if you, as soon as you say a person's racist, they're going to become defensive and not at all hear what you're talking about. But if you can make it by about the behavior or the action that that person engaged in, then that changes the whole story. So I think that that's very integral to like having productive conversations and actually trying to get people to change their behavior or even their mindset.
Especially, I would think, because so often their mindset is not totally conscious. It's just, you know, something that's ingrained from when they were little.
Right. I think that, you know, as a white person, like from the time I was born, like I was inundated with, you know, white supremacy, like when I was a child. And I think it's not quite the same for young people, but like the vast majority of all the images, positive images I would see on TV or in the movies were of white people. And when I read the history books, it was white people history. And you know, they might give mention, be like, oh, there are Native Americans here, but it didn't like even begin to scratch the surface of the genocide committed against the indigenous people here. So again, from the time that I was an infant, from like today, like I'm always surrounded by images and by our culture that's teaching us, you know, white is right. And we see it, you know, all over the place. Like think about it, like Disney, for example, and all of their Disney princesses and all their so-called masterpieces for like decades. Wow. It was white people, and eventually they started to be racially diverse. You know, but it took them like years after
when
that.
When I was a kid, they certainly weren't at all diverse.
No, not at all. Yeah, and it's not just the racism there, but it's also, you know, the patriarchy, like all the princesses needing, or the vast majority of them needing to be saved by the prince, you know, and not having agency on their own. They're just like there because they're, you know, conventionally beautiful or perceived to be conventionally beautiful. So yeah, those are the images that, you know, everybody in this country, I think they're near enough as not to matter in this country, was raised with. You know, I don't know anybody that didn't see at least a few Disney movies growing up. So the point is that that's just one example of that, you know, this cultural racism just inundating everywhere, which is, you know, has a huge effect on people's psyche. You know, it's like it just becomes the norm. And we see this manifestations in like seemingly like really innocuous ways, like even in our language, when you think of like a term like a white lie. It's like, oh, the white lie, it's not that bad, you know? Why are we saying it's a white lie? Because we're equating that with white supremacy, where white is right. And it's like, oh, we're creating this iconic, like this, that word that I'm forgetting how to pronounce. But anyway, we're creating like icons of, you know, white versus dark. And then like the white lie, which is the not the bad lie, or the black sheep of the family. Oh, so why is like that person in the family the black sheep, you know? Because we're perpetuating this culture of white supremacy.
Well, that's, I don't know, it's a lot to think about.
Yeah. And
it's hard to imagine. I also grew up in a fairly, in an urban neighborhood, but it was pretty white. And you wonder when you're inundated with all those images, how you feel if you're not white.
Right, which is something I can only like begin to imagine. I have no idea. You know, but relatedly, like, a lot of white people don't think of themselves as white. They just think of themselves as people. So they operate in the world. And I know this because I thought of myself this way too. And I've talked to the vast majority of people that have since come to recognize, you know, racism as, or other forms of oppression as, you know, a system of oppression. You know, though I might, prior to having my eyes open to this, I could walk into a grocery store in a small town where the small town is predominantly white, and I just see other people like me. But if I saw a person of color, that person would stand out. So I'm thinking that that person's living a racialized life because they're the person. But I'm also living a very racialized life because even though I don't reckon, like, I'm interacting with other white people in a way that a person of color isn't. And so even though that it's become normalized for me, it's still a very racialized existence, you know. So that's why when I talk to other white folks about, you know, racism, for example, or other men about patriarchy, or other cis folks about, you know, transgender oppression. And today, by the way, is the annual Transgender Day of Visibility. So that's an important thing as well. The point is that everybody's operating based on like the way that we were raised in this culture, and it's different for everybody, and we have to recognize that, but we have to recognize how things are perpetuated in our everyday behavior and actions, and the things that we happen to, and just everything around us,
Well, I'm struck by how you said you used to just think of yourself as just a person without a label, and I think that really is true. Maybe on the cultural level, that we can represent ourselves, but if some white guy shoots up a school, it doesn't reflect on everyone.
Right, that's absolutely.
It doesn't reflect on everyone in his age group, in his racial group, in his religious group, in his ethnic group.
Right.
But if someone of color does that, then it does. It's like generalized to everyone being equally guilty by association.
Right.
And we've gone to wars over that. That people who have brown skin and speak Arabic do something to our country, and we go after totally different people who are brown skinned and speak Arabic, who have nothing to do with it.
Right.
So I think that. That might be one manifestation of being the top dog, is you get to just be a person.
Yeah, and not be, white people are, any individual white person isn't a representative of their race. There's this seminal essay written quite a long time ago, decades ago, called White Privilege and Unpacking the Invisible Knapsack by Peggy McIntosh. She actually makes a list of all of these different white privileges that she recognized that she had. And so a list of 50 things. And one of them is, about not being representative of their race as a white person. I recommend that everybody read this. If you're not already familiar with it, there's all kinds of examples where you can find it online. If you just type into a search engine, Unpacking the Invisible Knapsack. Where a lot of people start with doing anti-racism work.
Now, one of the reasons that racism and other social injustices have persisted, I think, is that there are people who get advantages out of it. But what would you say would be the advantages of us if we could really achieve justice?
How would the world be a better place? Using race as an example, racism is a disease, and it's a disease that's infecting our world, like humanity at large. I want to focus on the United States because that's where, my knowledge base is. But racism is a disease that's infecting the entire United States, and it's infecting us all negatively. It's in so many different ways. So we need to eradicate this disease, which is racism, in order for all us to flourish, And I think that, we're all benefit. People will often say, how does this benefit me? But of course it benefits white folks, because this is a disease that it's in so many different ways.
Now, I know we're focusing on racism, but I wanted to talk a little bit about economic justice. There are, we mentioned a little bit how people who are incarcerated, their whole lives, they're playing catch up afterwards. But can we talk a little bit about what kind of economic injustices are going on at the same time? What we can do about them?
Yeah, I probably not as capable to talk about that in a proficient manner. But I do want to say that, because it's related, and I mentioned this to you earlier, so that I'm not accusing you of doing this at all, but a lot of people in my direct experience while doing this work, white people specifically, will talk about growing up poor and then say that that's, as a form of oppression, which it absolutely is, but then they'll say that it has nothing to, racism isn't a problem, because it's oppression exists because I'm poor. It doesn't matter that, I'm white, because like they, a lot of people refuse. It's essentially a bait and switch. Right. Be like, I don't want to talk racism. Let's talk about poverty because I'm white and that's what I know.
Right.
Which is absolutely a problem, but you can't unlink
right.
them.
And it isn't really the same. I mean, it's linked, but it isn't the same magnitude of problem.
Right.
I think in terms of racism plus economic oppression, you mentioned that so much of the wealth of this country, though it's in the hands of very few people now, was really acquired off the backs, on the backs of slaves, on indentured workers, on
all the wealth in this country was stolen by the First Nations that were here.
That's true. So it started even before that.
Right. And then to this day, we were still, using parts of the global south and the so-called third world as resource colonies, stealing all the wealth of the folks there. So, this has been going on for centuries, and it's going on to this day.
And it affects our, when you say that, we're reminded that it affects our foreign policy, that our policies that we have, diplomatically or not, with countries like Northern Europe are quite different from how we treat South America or Africa or other parts of the global south.
Right. I mean, I personally believe that the vast majority of our foreign policy is based on exploitation. It's like, what can we get from this country? It's not, what do we do to help? The more resources, I don't want to get too far into this, but it's essentially the curse of resources, where even if we talk about, let's say, Central Appalachia in this country, which has been, blessed or cursed, depending on how you look at it, with vast amounts of coal, those places with the most coal are some of the poorest places in the country. We're extracting, countless dollars, like literally countless dollars worth of wealth from this area, but none of it stays there. It's absolutely Central Appalachia as a resource colony for the rest of the country, exploitation.
And life for the miners is really rough.
Right. Right. That's
not just financially, but the day-to-day.
Right. Because because no one outside of Appalachia cares about, a poor miner from Appalachia. That's the reality, So again, it's a resource colony where we're stealing, not just the resources, if you can call coal a resource, but we're the lifeblood of the people in the communities that are in Appalachia, as an example. And so that, I think, ties into economic oppression, that still continues to this day. And that's not even talking about mountaintop removal and the horrors of mountaintop removal.
Now, we have about 10 minutes left, and so I wanted to spend a little bit of time on something else you're up to these days.
Sure.
You recently opened a bookstore, you became a small business owner, and I was interested in what that experience is like, partly because one of the remedies for some of the economic injustices is small businesses that are owned by real people, not big corporations.
Right. Yeah, I opened a bookstore. It's called Bennett's Books. It's in Deep River. Largely I did it because I love books. And it's just great to have a job where I'm surrounded by books all the time. The thing is that I'm very much not a capitalist, so it's tough to be a small business owner because people come in and they're the books are priced. And first of all, I have thousands of books, and no book is over $10, and the vast majority are $5 or less, but people will come up, and the books will be, $17, but I don't want to charge people $17. I'm how about $15? Because, it's, again,
so they come in with that yard sale mentality.
Well, no, they're not. I'm doing
that.
Right, because, even though, I'm struggling even to keep the doors open, it's still, there's the exchange of money is something that I'm not at all comfortable with, and I hope I never become comfortable with, because the reality of being a small business owner, I think every great community has a bookstore. There's lots of great quotes that will kind of attest to that, and our community hadn't for a long time, and I figured if nobody else was going to do it, I would try. But really, even if the bookstore can become really financially successful, and by that I mean just making some kind of profit, the vast majority of that money is going to go into things that make the community better. It's right now a sole proprietorship, the bookstore, but what I really like to do, and I mean I do plan on doing is actually having it be a nonprofit. So, you know, the folks that work there, the employees can get paid, but anything beyond, you know, what what's needed to keep the business in business will go to different community programs or something like that, or it's just, you know, staying in the community.
Well, just in general, small businesses of all sorts, whether they're nonprofit or for-profit, right. Money that you spend there mostly stays in the community.
Right. And that's like absolutely true with me because, you know, personally, I don't shop at anywhere that's a corporation if I can do anything to help it. Like, I think that the one exception that you can catch me on there is like buying gas because it's impossible to buy gas from a corporation. But, you know, there's a Walgreens in our town that I have never been in and will never go in, like, you know. Yeah, and there's also a Dunkin' Donuts that opened up down the road, which is really unfortunate because as you drive into our small little town that's really, like, in a lot of ways idyllic, you know, the gateway in our community is welcome to Deep River, here's this Dunkin' Donuts. It's nauseating is what it is. But the point is that Deep River is great because we do have such a vibrant small business community, and the business owners, because I've joined the Deep River Merchants Association, you know, they're people from the community whose children go to school in the community, and they're supporting other local businesses. And yes, the money stays there, and you know, it's the way that, you know, our economy should operate, not based on this idea of a McDonald's going into a town and, you know, exploiting all the workers and everything, the evil things that McDonald's can do, and then sending the money to the shareholders. Like, that's the exact opposite, which is, you know, directly related to, you know, economic oppression, you know, classism, capitalism.
And sometimes, of course, the only jobs available in places that have been flooded with these big businesses are jobs that there's no way a person can live on the wages.
Right, absolutely. Right, it's yeah, yeah, things are bad.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I worked for Head Start for many years and also in child care centers that were subsidized. And it was amazing how many parents had multiple part-time jobs. And they had young kids also. And it was kind of heartbreaking that they'd have their children in a child care center during the day. They'd pick them up. They'd have dinner with them. And then they'd be off to tend bar or work night shift at the casino or something after they had had a day job in fast food. And it's like there was nothing to support the emotional life of the family there.
There's the television.
Yeah, which is its own problem, which we don't have time to get.
Right.
Well, actually, we could go into not television necessarily specifically, but in the last 5 minutes, maybe talk a little bit about how the media has functioned in terms of perpetuating our system.
Right. I mean, and our systems of oppression, you know, and there's many of them out there that we can identify and, I guess, label, for lack of a better term. The media plays a very complicit role in perpetuating it. And, like, it's hard to say, oh, it's because, you know, it would be simple if there was, like, well, I guess in some ways there is. There's, like, the media conglomerations, and we have more and more media controlled by, like, fewer and fewer people. So, yeah, in some ways that might be true. But what we see is, like, in a lot of ways we are the media because what we watch reflects our values in a lot of ways. And I think that that's where we can see some progress. I thought about bringing this up, and I guess I am bringing it up, but there's a show that's hugely popular right now, The Walking Dead. The Walking Dead is a show about zombies and like life in the zombie apocalypse. But the point I want to talk about is that it's been problematic, very problematic, like extremely problematic in its portrayal of race, but it's also been really, really great. And, you know, we see really strong characters of color on that show, which that's virtually not, or it had previously been virtually non-existent in the vast majority of what we'd see on TV. Of course, there's exceptions, but it's a good thing that we can see, you know, an Asian character, because Asians are hugely underrepresented in mass media right now. It's one of the strongest, best, long-living, coolest characters on the show. So again, like, I think that that's good because we are the media, again, producing. And I think that more and more media companies are starting to recognize that, like, in order to make a profit, they have to appeal to like a broader audience or a more diverse audience. And I wanted to mention something about diversity. A lot of people use diversity or diverse as a synonym for race. It's like, oh, this is a diverse crowd because there's people of color. But that's not actually the definition of diversity. Diversity is like essentially, by definition, the comparison of differences or similarities within a group. So yes, you can have racial diversity, but you can also have gender diversity or sex diversity, or you can have age diversity, economic diversity. So I'm very careful about using that term. You know, if I'm going to use diversity, what type of diversity I'm talking about. So, you know, on The Walking Dead, a lot of racial diversity and some gender diversity. But again, like, media in some ways, I think, is doing a better job just a little bit, you know?
Yeah. At least depending on what you're watching.
Right.
Some of the network TV is still terrible.
Oh, yeah, I think the vast majority of it is. Everybody should read instead. But, yeah, there's
some glimmer. And we know where you're the person who get books.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
I guess maybe we have like 2 minutes left. Talk a little bit again about what Allies for Social Justice does and how people could get involved if they're interested.
Sure. I mean, essentially, like I said, we use Facebook. We have an email address that's monitored. It's alliesforsocialjustice@gmail.com. So if anybody's interested in any kind of work that's related to anti-oppression, anti-racism, or anything else, they can contact us if they want, you know, a facilitated conversation. It could be a nonprofit. It could be a student group. It could even be really a business if they're trying to, like, you know, increase their diversity work, which is what a lot of organizations like, oh, we're expanding our diversity work, things like that. They can contact us and, you know, we could try to figure out a way if there's a way that we can help. And like I said, we've been primarily been offering workshops. You know, we'll come in and we'll do a workshop based on the needs of the organization. Like, this is actually the template for a workshop created by a good friend and colleague of mine who unfortunately moved to California. And lost for the East Coast. But the point is that we have like templates, and this one's very applicable because it's very moldable to different situations. But yeah, it's all free of charge, you know, as long as we can get there, we're willing to do it. And there's a bunch of us from around the country, so there's a good chance if people are committed to this that we might be able to help them out.
And then watch the Facebook page for the community conversation in April.
Right, absolutely.
Well, thank you, Colin. Nice to have you back.
It was definitely my pleasure.
Next week, Art Costa and Cindy Barry will be on the show, and they'll be talking about this summer at farmers markets in New London.
Cool.
So we'll see you then, and thanks again.
Of course, thank you.
Karma's gonna hit you. Gonna knock you right on the head.